From beautiful downtown Sacramento, it's time for Beach Blanket Fort Bingo.
Beach Blanket Fort Bingo. Beach Blanket.
Everybody, my name is Steve Schnee, and welcome to Beach Blanket Fort Bingo. We've got a great show for you today, but before I introduce our very special guest, I'd like to introduce my co-host. He's tall. He plays bass. He has the cat. He has a girlfriend. He has a platinum sales award, and he has a lot of really cool friends. He's the star of Music's Greatest Mysteries on Access TV, and he's often referred to as the Clark Gable of alternative rock. And yet they still can't get his order right at Jack in the Box. He's my friend and yours, and his name is Ronnie Barnett.
Hey, thank you, Steve. Everything you said is true.
And now I'd like to introduce our very special guest. While many of you are familiar with Donnie Iris, this gentleman is his musical partner in crime. He writes or co-writes nearly all of the material for Donnie Iris and the Cruisers. He plays keyboards for the bands, produces the albums, arranges the band's incredible vocal harmonies. He's the architect of audio, the musician's magician, and the crafter of cool. And his name is Mark Avsec. Welcome to the Blanket Fort, Mark.
Well, thank you. And it's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for the kind words.
Now, before we start talking about the reissues of the first four Donnie Iris and the Cruisers albums, let's go back to the beginning. Do you remember the exact moment you decided that you wanted to be a musician, or was it a singular moment or maybe a series of events?
Well, you know, I mean, from the time I was really young, I remember being like seriously like 3 or 4 and being just captivated with music. And I remember reading, my parents had, or there were some hymn books in a corner that had musical notation on them. And I used to just stare at the musical notation, wondering what this language was. And then my grandfather, I used to march around in the Mickey Mouse Club with toy instruments. And my grandfather gave me a real instrument when I was 4 years old, an accordion. And I'm a Slovenian kid from the Slovenian part of Cleveland, Ohio. And so everybody was into accordion music. And so that started my musical journey. And when I was about 4 years old, began taking lessons shortly thereafter and competing in actually classical accordion music competitions that were rather serious. I actually won when I was 9 years old. I was Ohio State accordion champion in my age group. And that was the start of it, you know. And then the Beatles, you know, were on Ed Sullivan, and that changed my life like it changed many of our generation's lives.
Now, you know, obviously you're known as a keyboardist, and that started back with the accordion. When you decided to form the band to get into music, was the keyboards always going to be your choice of instrument, or did you consider even taking up guitar, with the arrival of the Beatles?
You know, I formed a couple of little stupid bands, shortly after the Beatles came out, and I was playing accordion in them. And I remember Freddie and the Dreamers came out, and they had an accordion in the band. So I thought, well, maybe I have a shot at this. I didn't know anything about zydeco music at the time. So I didn't know there was such a thing as zydeco where the accordion could be cool. I learned that later on.
Yeah.
I never considered switching to guitar back then. But what happened is when I was about 12, 13 years old, really, there was a more serious, quote unquote, band down the street that was playing the music of the day. And that happened to include Doors music and some of the R&B stuff where there was an organ. So I, convinced my father to take out a loan that I would help repay for a Farfisa organ, which was not quite a box, but similar to what was used on Doors records. And I could learn from here. I have perfect pitch. So I could quickly learn like the solos and the intro to Blight My Fire. So when I tried out for this band down the street, having the ability to play that kind of thing cemented me into the band. So even though they were like 17 years old, I joined as a 13-year-old. So that began my journey as a keyboardist. So then I was a keyboard player. Play the fucking music, right, boy. Play the fucking music, right. Play the fucking music, right, boy. Lay down the boogie and play the fucking music till you die.
Many of us know you from, you know, the rock and pop oriented material with Donnie, but you were also a member of Wild Cherry. You were a member of an AOR band called Breathless, which also featured Kevin Valentine. Was it an exciting challenge to be involved in these projects that were so musically diverse from each other?
Well, you know, at the time Wild Cherry broke, I was studying composition with a fairly well-known teacher that had taught, my understanding is he had taught Yosef Zawinul, and he had arranged for Stan Kenton and some other heavyweights. And I was studying to be maybe a film composer, and then I was doing session work, and one of the songs I was called to do session work for was Play That Funky Music and some of the other songs on that first album. I'll share with you that I tried a number of things keyboard-wise on Play That Funky Music, and nothing really worked because it was really done without keyboards. And the song did impress me. I mean, I'm not saying this just after the fact. When I heard the song in the studio, I thought, well, that's pretty damn catchy. You know, I think that's really got something there. And Robert Parisi deserves all the credit for that. I mean, he put that all together. That was his thing. So he had said to me, look, because I played on other songs on the album, he said, look, if the album hits, would you consider being our keyboard player? And I said I would. And that's what happened. It was sort of like, the song was going to be a hit. I thought it would be a great experience for me to do it. I know it was a little diverse musically from what we ended up doing and what I had always been into, which was more, at the time, a lot of California rock, Joni Mitchell and Crosby, Stills and Nash, et cetera. But I was playing in a band at the time that did the songs of the day, which included a lot of the disco dance-oriented material. So I went from playing like a small club with that band. My first gig with Wild Cherry was in D.C., Washington, D.C., at the Capitol Center, it was called at the time. 20,000 people opening up for Graham Central Station. And then we went on tour with Average White Band and the Isley Brothers for about 6 months, and a lot of the bands like Cool and the Gang and Earth, Wind and Fire and the Jacksons and Stevie Wonder and those great bands of and artists of that stature. So I was thrilled to be on the road. I learned a lot being in Wild Cherry. I learned a lot about making records. I learned just how records are put together in the studio. So
I wanted to ask real quick, Mark, what were you wearing on stage during that Wild Cherry? silks and, did you have a mustache? Like, did you?
I couldn't grow a mustache, or I might have. But I wore some really things I wish I hadn't worn. They exist. The Grammy performance is one of them. And a performance at Midnight Special, where I had on this full-length tuxedo-type thing without a shirt. It's a shame to say. It seemed okay at the time.
Well, yes.
But, in retrospect, I wish I hadn't done it because they do exist on the internet.
I'm searching now.
Don Kirshner's rock concert and Merv Griffin and Dinah Shore show. So they all exist somewhere on the internet. We did all those things when the record was peaking. Mm-hmm. And it, you know, was certainly a huge hit. As I said, I think Robert Parisi deserves all the credit for that. I mean, mm-hmm. he had put that all together, and the band that existed that at that time, you know, so I was a session musician. So I give all the credit to like Ronnie Beidle, who played drums, and Brian mm-hmm. Bassett on guitar, Alan Wentz on bass, and mainly Robert for really having the vision to put that together. Huge hit. It's been called a one-hit wonder. It was a huge one-hit wonder. And it was then descending. And as it descended and looking for longevity, and as Robert continued to develop the sound, he thought it would be great to have somebody like Donnie Iris, who had had the rapper in the band. So Donnie joined for the very last album, mm-hmm. basically, and he played some dates with us on tour. That's where I met him. And then Donnie okay. and I roomed together. And two things happened from that point on. Number one, he and I became fast friends. I just love the guy personally. Mm-hmm. Donnie's a very sort of very laid back guy and mm-hmm. very kind of happy go lucky guy. And I like that about him. I gravitated towards him because I'm exactly the opposite. I'm like full of angst, full of ambition. So he needed me, and I needed somebody like him. I was looking for a lead singer, frankly, that I could sort of sing through, and mm-hmm. I could have this vehicle for some of the music that was in my head. Donnie, I don't think, was looking for anything at the time. He was really just such a laid-back guy, taking life as it comes, but he was very open to having a partnership with me. And going into the studio and seeing what would happen. So we sort of made a pact that we would, you know, after Wild Cherry, you know, we'll see that through. But after that, we would experiment in the studio and I would produce and write and he would be the singer. And we were committed to trying to do that. The second thing that happened was I began smoking again because Donnie smoked. So we were rooming together, and so wasn't his fault. I'm not blaming it on him, but I, you know, got into that for a while again, and so we went into the studios, both of us smoking, and crafting this sound that became Donnie Iris and the Cruisers.
When you first decided to start the band together, did you or both of you already have sort of an idea of what you wanted to sound like, or did it evolve organically?
Well, the first wave, we didn't really know what we wanted it to sound like. I was still very influenced by the Wild Cherry thing, and I was influenced by the Belkin Maduri organization, mainly Carl Maduri's mm-hmm. team, you know, trying to fit into some designated area. I wasn't crazy about some of the early things we were doing, except I was stacking Donnie's voice, which mm-hmm. was something I continued to do. That was different. You know, we would even do more danceable oriented material, and I would stack Donnie's voice, you know, a ton of times, and it created this certain sound. So this experimentation with his voice, where I would use certain compression on his voice and EQ through this board at Jerry's studio in Beaver Falls, and these wonderful stacks would emerge of his voice, that stuck. The kind mm-hmm. of music didn't. Eventually, I was, you know, getting rid of the dance-oriented material. I was very much into the Pretenders at the time, which was like this very urgent sounding music. Their first album, played with reckless abandon, which I really mm-hmm. enjoyed, and Kevin Valentine enjoyed too. But I wanted to combine that with very singable melodies, very melodic tunes, combined with these stacked vocals. You know, Donnie's voice is very, interesting. His natural singing voice is not all that, is great, but is not all that special in and of itself. I mean, it's not like, he doesn't have a natural rock sounding voice like a Lou Gramm,
or right,
maybe even a Steve Perry. His natural sounding voice is kind of normal sounding. I mean, it's kind of limited. His range is not as high as you might think. When he gets to about a G above middle C, he's already into his gruff natural voice, which is kind of, cool for some things, but I know it very well. But then when you combine it with his falsetto voice, which is very different, that a lot of singers don't have, I know where he can get into that falsetto voice, and stacking his voice in that falsetto voice creates this very lush, very pillow, like I used to say, of very lush harmonies. Mm-hmm. And we made great use of that on a lot of tunes, including Leah, where the backgrounds are all this lush pillow voice and his falsetto voice. And then, of course, we started experimenting. I remember one night we were playing live in Wild Cherry doing Ain't That Peculiar, which Robert used to let Donnie sing. And Donnie would sing it. And at the very end, he would go to some sort of screaming ad-libs. And I always remembered that. And I thought, well, that's really cool. So we experimented with that for the first time on Aaliyah at the end, obviously.
Yeah.
Where I suggested to Donnie, let's try a scream here. And he would just kind of go for himself. And, that trademark scream at the end of Aaliyah was, suggested by me, but, nailed by him. And, I just kind of was standing on my chair, just literally going, that's it, And
yeah.
That was a very exciting moment in the studio. I wish we had a film of doing that song, because it was, trial by error in the studio.
You think about somebody singing in falsetto, and somebody might initially, Frankie Valli or whatever, but Donnie, it just has this amazing, emotionally expressive voice. And then added with the songwriting and the production, and it's all, everything coming together are key elements of the sound. Now, to sort of go off what you were talking about before, was the plan originally to be a band with Donnie up front, or was it always going to kind of be Donnie and a band?
Well, we just were working on a project. We didn't know what we were going to call it. And then at some point I suggested, let's just call it Donnie Iris. We didn't even know we would have a name for the band.
Mm-hmm.
I was perfectly happy just being the guy behind the scenes, to call it something like Iris and AVSEC. I wasn't really into that. I mean, it's, people don't really see what I contribute unless you're in the studio watching us work together, because I really am more of a guy behind the scenes.
Yeah.
And then live, I just play the keyboards and I sing. And now if you ever get a chance to see our band, I wish you would, because I actually feel we're better now than we ever have been on stage. I mean, Donnie is as good as ever. And when you're as old as he is and you get on the stage and do what he's doing, and the band is killer still. It's cooler as we get older. It's cooler as Donnie gets older. But at the time, I suggested, let's just call it Donnie Iris. So that's what we were going to do. And I would be the writer and the producer behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. And then eventually, the band got together three times to cut basic tracks for that first album. First time we got together, we cut Agnes, Leah, I think we jammed on a song that became I Can't Hear You, and maybe another track that I had brought in, we cut. And when they would leave, they would spend about 3 hours with us in the studio. We cut the tracks and we handpicked these musicians, and they're all great. And, we'll talk about the reissues, but as I listened to them, I was just reminded how great everybody in the band was. And these records came together with every member of the band making a contribution. You know, Marty has this unique way of playing. Donnie saw him in a band called The Pulse and said, you know what, since we're doing this project, Spark, he used to call me Spark. He said, he still does. He said, I found a guitar player I think would be so weird and so great for this project. So I said, great. I trusted his judgment. I said to Donnie, I know a drummer I think will be great for this project. He's a great drummer. He's our drummer in Breathless. Donnie's like, great. Then Donnie said, I've heard of this bass player named Al Britton McLean, who is a monster. Let's bring him in for this project. And so we did. And so that's how we all met, shook hands before we, you know, and within a half hour, we're cutting Agnes and Leah.
Wow.
We had just met each other. And everybody in the band is just unique. And then eventually the band, we decided to call it the Cruisers. And then so it became Donnie Iris and the Cruisers. And we formed the band basically to fit the records and that sort of thing. And then every member of the band, I'll tell you, when I'm listening to the reissues, you know, I'm reminded how good Kevin is, how good Marty is. Because I would bring the songs in and they would be sketches and suggestions. But like in Leah, I would suggest to Al Britton, you know, I'm hearing the bump, 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 bump at the beginning of Leah. And he would play it, but then he would play it in his own way and embellish it in his own way. And Al Britton is just a monster bass player. I'm not saying he's as good as James Jamerson from Motown, but I will say that Donnie and I would just freak out when we would do sessions. We'd play a song like My Girl for him, okay, off the King Cool album, and he would begin to play his bass part, and we would sometimes just overdub part of his bass part, and he would sit there and just riff these tremendous parts, and Donnie and I would just enjoy the hell out of these things, and he would go from take to take just improvising. And each time he would play it, it would just be a gem. You know, he had such command of his instrument and such feel that it would just be amazing.
The bass line on Leah is incredible. And it's incredibly original. And
you're right. I mean, it's just bump, 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 which is what I suggested. But when he does these,
exactly.
This, and he's attacking the bass. And I put it up in the mix. So it's such a big part of the record, and you know, Al Britton is just a monster player.
Names in rock, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Well, I got a great story about that. You know, Al Britton McLean you're talking about?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, can I cuss on this podcast?
Absolutely. Right, absolutely.
Well, we were touring with Nazareth. There was some drinking going on at the end of the night, and Al Britton is biracial. And so he's a very good-looking guy. And he looks different. He looks, you can't make out what race he is. And in fact, he is African-American and Caucasian. And in Nazareth, they're all Scottish. So they were talking and about Scottish names and Al Britton. They couldn't believe his name. And so Al Britton said to them, well, my name is Al Britton McLean. And so they said, no way. And so Al Britton pulled out his driver's license and showed him his driver's license, Al Britton McLean. And he said, Al Britton McLean, well, fuck me. And it was one of those lines that from then on out, every time for a while there, we'd say, Al Britton McLean, well, fuck me. We all laughed about it.
Yeah, the thing about Donnie Iris and the Cruisers is the fact that, you know, obviously you and Donnie are really, you know, right up there with two of the greatest collaborators in rock, in my opinion. But these other three guys are amazing. Marty's guitar solos are so emotional. He plays only the notes that the songs need. And he plays them in a unique way to where you can actually, even though each album sounds different, you know, oh, okay, that's Marty Lee.
Yep. So, and some of the solos we worked on, you know, in the studio to have themes and motifs and to develop, and they were crafted. But Marty thinks differently. I mean, when you play a song for Marty, the parts he'll naturally come up with in terms of just his basic guitar part will be something very different than maybe than any other guitar player might come up with. He thinks differently, which is what Donnie and I really loved about Marty right from the start. So, and he continues to be a very good friend and has been with the band from the beginning, like I have. Donnie and myself and Marty are the three longest members of the band without a break. Kevin left the band for a good portion of time, but is now back with us. And
that's great.
And then Al Britton had to leave the band. He moved to Seattle. We're still very friendly with Al Britton. We have brought him back for special occasions, and that was a real treat. But then we got a bass player named Paul Gall, who you may not know. He's been with us for like 25 years or something.
Yeah.
Like that. And Paul is a great addition to the band. You know, he plays very well and he sings, and he's just a great person. So. When I was joking, I hope you
was there a label war over Donnie Iris and the Cruisers after the release of the single? And if so, why did you choose MCA?
Well, so I was working with a production company out of Cleveland, Ohio. And I had gained the confidence of this company that I could make records in the studio. So I arranged what was called a spec deal with Jerry's studio and Jerry Reed in Beaver Falls, Pennsylvania. I must mention at this point that besides Donnie and myself as the core members of this team in the beginning, Jerry Reed, the owner of Jerry's studio, was absolutely a core member with Donnie and me. We couldn't have made those records without Jerry Reed, not only because he offered his studio on a spec deal, which meant that nobody was paying for studio time until we maybe had a hit record, or I couldn't have made those records, I wouldn't have had permission to do it. And so I mean, I could spend a lot of time there, but also because Jerry, yes, he was a good engineer, but more than that, he was a wonderful person who made me feel comfortable in the studio that I could experiment with so many things. And he tolerated that and he enjoyed it. He just looked forward to our sessions. We'd come in there at like 7 at night and go to 2 in the morning. And he was just happier than a pig and shit all the while. We were just experimenting. So there was no label at the time. We didn't even know if there would be an album. This was totally experimentation. When it was done, I would drive home. I remember with the master in my car that I couldn't wait to play it for the Belkin Maduri organization, which I did at what we called the office, you know, the Belkin-Maduri office. One day I played them the record. So we signed a production deal. I signed a production deal as a producer, and Donnie signed a production deal as an artist with the Belkin-Maduri organization. So we were signed to them. And then they owned the project at that point, and it was theirs to make a deal with a record company.
Okay.
No record company wanted the act at the time when they were was shopped. So they put it out on their own little private label called Midwest Records.
Yes.
When they put it out, Chris Maduri, who was affiliated with that company, did a fantastic job getting some radio airplay. And he got airplay on WMMS in Cleveland, WBCN in Boston, WDVE in Pittsburgh. The album at that time, if you were played on the radio and you attracted, you know, a lot of listeners in what we called phones, they would call the station. Who the hell is that? We want to know who that is. That all happened. And we started selling records to the extent we could, they could get them distributed in stores. When that happened, it started charting on Billboard. And then there was, I don't know if it was a label war, but Chrysalis was interested, I remember, and MCA Universal was interested. I'm not sure why we picked MCA Universal. It wasn't even our decision to make. We may have had some input, but the Belka Madura organization picked MCA Universal. They negotiated with them, got a deal, and then MCA Universal put out the record. Since I showed her what to touch, she left the girlish ways behind. I used to work from 9 to 5, but now I'm working overtime. When I get home from work, I snap my chain. Don't ask me how to explain. You know I never complain. She loves me once and then she loves me again. Cause she's so mad.
Was it the full album you had recorded before signing the deal? Because I know Bring On the 80s was the first single, and that's featured on that.
Yeah, and you're right. And that never, you know, they put that out locally and nothing
else
with that. Mm-hmm. But we did I wanted to do the entire album. I wanted to make a statement. Mm-hmm. And then Leah happened to be the lead single.
Okay.
And really the only single from that album. We had the whole album and the deal was proffered for the whole album.
For viewers, first album, Back in the Streets, released in 1980. And of course, this is the album that features Aaliyah, which remains a classic slice of rock music, still played on the radio to this day. You know, it's been called AOR. It's been called melodic rock. It's been called pop rock and even new wave. How would you classify the band's sound? What would you call Donnie Iris and the Cruisers?
Well, I'm not saying it's entirely unique, but it's an amalgam of really all of us, I mean, who participated in the record. I mean, I envisioned it with the urgency of I remember trying to motivate the band to play with reckless abandon in the studio to these songs I had brought in and the sketches I brought in and the jams we did. I always made the policy on every record we would have jams. So, cause I wanted every guy in the band to have some writing credit on the record. And so that's how I Can't Hear You evolved and You're Only Dreaming.
Right.
Love Is Like a Rock. But I would encourage this reckless playing. So it's part that, so I hoped it was a rock record or, you know, I didn't want to make just a dance record. I wanted to have like real feel on the records, but then it was an amalgam of that with the melodic songwriting that I, you know, maybe to a fault I have, you know, I just have this and Donnie would maybe counterbalance that with his street smarts and we, you know, his sense of, his the R&B stuff he sang over the years and his coolness factor. And it's an amalgam of the way Kevin plays, very steady, very rock playing with Al Britton's soulfulness and Marty's weirdnesses. And, you know, my vision and Donnie's voice that I don't know what that is, you know, but it became, yes, a melodic tune, that was stacked like crazy. So you had these unusual sounding vocals. I was into Phil Spector at the time. I was into Roy Thomas Baker even more.
Yeah.
So I was listening to records that Roy Thomas Baker was doing. He was stacking the hell out of voices. I liked that kind of sound. I liked doing that with Donnie. In part, it was the studio we were in, but it was a homemade board. So it didn't have the fidelity necessarily of a Neve console or some of the other state-of-the-art boards, even an MCI. And so I had to make use of what the board would give me, and it would give me good compression. And I noticed certain vocals would rub up at a certain frequency the way we did them with Donnie. So we made use of what the board would give us And so it's just a happy accident of the way everything was done. You know, if it was done later on for Fortune 410, we went to a different studio, Beachwood Studios in Cleveland. I couldn't have made Leah on that board. It just we could have had the same playing, but I'm telling you, it wouldn't have sounded the same.
Right.
It everything has to come together.
All I can tell you is the way that you arrange the vocals on all these albums, there's the sophistication of the Beach Boys, and they're just as heavenly as gospel music.
Well, thank you. I mean, that's high praise, because obviously I love the Beach Boys stuff. And if you listen to Pet Sounds, they have that one release where it's just the tracks and you can just hear the vocals a cappella. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that stuff's amazing. I wasn't really channeling Brian Wilson at the time. I was aware of it, but it was really basically, my thing as a producer, we were limited to 24 tracks at the time. That, in retrospect, was a good thing because it forces you to make decisions. And the modus operandi when we cut Leah and all the albums we cut was we would do basic tracks on maybe 9 or 10 tracks of that 24. The drums, bass on one track of guitar, one ghost keyboard track. So maybe that would be like 9, 10, 11 tracks. We would then, I would have the song and we would immediately start tracking background vocals because I needed all those other tracks to fill them up with background vocals and to mix down to a track with leaving one track adjacent because you couldn't mix to an adjacent track. You'd get feedback and crosstalk, et cetera. And so I would do that like multiple times. We'd fill up like 9 tracks, mix, 9 tracks, mix, 9 tracks, mix. My standard was 27 tracks of vocals for just a basic bed. And that's what we did in Leah. But then I had the counterpoint stuff where we did 12 tracks each. I needed a lot of empty tracks to be able to do all that.
Yeah.
So that's what we did. I mean, one of the reasons the arrangements became so vocal heavy is because that was the first thing I did was arrange the vocals with Donnie and mix them onto separate tracks. Then Marty would come back and I would then maybe stack a bunch of keyboards the same way. And we would build all the parts around the vocal interplays that were already down on the 24 track machine.
Back in the streets, so many great tracks, and none of them sound like Aaliyah, but all of them are just as great. Did you purposely produce this to be such a diverse collection, or it just ended up that way?
We were influenced by New Wave. Again, that playing I urged, the urgent style playing. So that was purposefully done. I wanted it like that. And then with these melodic songs, the songs came out the way they did. Shock Treatment was an unusual song because that was part of the old thing when we were experimenting before we got into this rock thing. That was when I refer to the earlier days when Donnie and I were experimenting, just finding our way. It was kind of a dance song called Get It On, and it was a stupid song and it was terrible. But we resuscitated it. It didn't even have Al Britton on bass. It had another bass player, Peckman, Robert Peckman, because he had come in to play on some of these old R&B bass songs. So we took that and I erased all the lyrics and vocals. And I just left the Get It On part and wrote a new song called Shock Treatment, where the Get It On is still on the record.
Yes.
But it became Shock Treatment, this weird song about somebody getting shock treatments. I won't tell you the genesis of that. But I'll save it for another time. Maybe too much of an overshare. But I wrote a song called Shock Treatment and we had some fun with it. So that had its own sound. Songs like Joking and Daddy Don't Live Here Anymore, Too Young to Love. I mean, they just were songs I had brought in and they became whatever they became.
The next album, King Cool, came out in 1981. The album was an entirely different beast. It was just as powerful and the songs were just as great, but the album was more emotional, maybe a pinch of sadness. Was this a difficult second album, you know, that we've often heard about, or did you purposely just sort of want to change the direction of the band?
You know, it wasn't a conscious change of direction at all. I didn't want to change the direction. I wanted to make a better album. You always do. I wrote a lot of those songs on the road when we were touring on the first album. Donnie and I got together in his basement and around his piano and tried to co-write some of the songs. I might bring in a sketch. We did it. Mm-hmm. Then Donnie and I would try and lay back and write the lyric together. They came in all shapes or forms. Love Is Like a Rock was the first thing we cut. And I remember I still loved the stacking thing I was doing. Yeah. So we started the whole album. We were still getting sounds. And in those days, it just seemed like it took forever to get sounds in the studio on drums. And Kevin and I were in the studio getting the drum sounds with Jerry. And we wanted a more room-oriented sound. And they had built this special room for us by that time called Kevin's Domain. The sign is still on the door. Jerry was sweet to do that. He built this room. And because we had success with the first album. So this room was more live sounding. It had hardwood floors, okay, and brick. And we set up Kevin's drum in there and experimented with beats. And we picked a beat that he had done and he stacked the hell out of his drums. And we looped the beat. By that time, Marty had gotten there and the three of us had pencils. Well, we recorded Kevin's track onto a two-track machine like you would do mixing down. We cut up that loop so that it would loop around and just repeat itself, because this is before computers, remember. And then Kevin held up one section of it. I held up one section of this loop. Marty held up one section of this loop. And it passed through the machine, and we were re-recording it back onto the 24-track machine, which is what we did for about 7 minutes. And we had this two-track in stereo drum loop now. That's what we had.
Yeah.
That was the beginning of Love Is Like a Rock. Then Marty experimented with guitar riffs over that, came up with the riff we all know. And I would be listening as the producer and just, you know, we would be crafting the lick together. And then he happened on that. It was just like, well, I think that's it. And then we stacked that a bit. That became Love Is Like a Rock. And then I wrote a song around it. I thought it was was it a difficult album to make? No, it was a labor of love. It was one of the happiest times in my life making that record. The concept emerged of this King Cool sort of character, which I got from a reviewer who saw us play at the Alma Combo in Toronto and called Donnie the new King of Cool. So I took that we decided to call the album King Cool and built a little bit on a concept there. It was a joy to make that record. It was made in the same way. Now the third album, I will say, it was not a joy. It turned into a real tense period. I think in not among the band members, but for me personally, I found it challenging. I'll tell you the reasons. Number one, we had picked up some bad 2-inch tape to start the record on. Jerry's didn't know about this bad 2-inch tape because they weren't like a major studio. So it never got noticed that this batch of Scotch 250 tape was bad. So about halfway through the album, with all the stacking I do, I realized that the tape was shedding onto the tape heads. So each pass through the tape heads would result in oxide coming off the tape, which means we were progressively losing highs on the record. So that really obviously bothered the hell out of me. I didn't know what the hell to do about it. We were like 60% through the recording when this happened. Wow. So that was a drag. So the first thing we had to do when I made the decision to go to New York to mix it, we had to make safety copies of the 2-inch master. And we had to actually make the record from the copies of the 2-inch master, which meant we lost a generation there. I was really pleasantly surprised the way the remasters turned out on the Rock Candy stuff, because I thought the mastering engineer had done a fantastic job restoring it to what was, you know, some semblance of the original thing. So we can go there later. But that was difficult because of that. Some really good songs on King Cool. Love Is Like a Rock. Part of it we never got to have released because I made a fundamental mistake, which was after mixing King Cool, which resulted in an all-night session at Media Sound in New York, to get it done with Michael Barbiero, who was the remix engineer, who did a fabulous job on that record. Loved working with Michael. And he was blown away by what we were doing. It was so funny. We would come in with our stuff and Michael would throw the whole thing up in the studio. He'd start with the drums. He'd start with the bass. Then he'd listen to some weird ass vocal part we were doing. Some weird, you know, it would just get progressively. He'd put up the tracks and he'd just look at me and Donnie and just kind of raise his eyebrows like, where the hell are you guys going with this? He got so into the music, and it was great having Michael's perspective, and he made it sound, you know, a lot better. We loved working with Michael. He was a key part of those mixes. And then it resulted, I had a set list or a track listing. And I believe we were going to lead with Love Is Like a Rock. Or I believe that was the first song. It wasn't Merrily, I'll tell you that. When we went into the studio to master, Jack Skinner, who was the mastering engineer, and I don't put this on Jack Skinner's.
Yeah.
It was my call. I was sleep deprived. Jack Skinner listened and loved Merrily. And he was so effusive about Merrily. I, in my sleep deprived state, made this decision, which you should never do, because I had made the decision on the track listing in a sober state, you know, really considering a lot of things. Had I just gone with my original list, history might have been changed, because they might have put Love Is Like a Rock out first as the first single. We may have had great success with it. And instead, Merrily was put out first. It was a good song, but maybe not an overt single. It didn't do as well as we hoped. It charted. Then they never got to That's the Way Love Ought to Be, which is maybe my favorite song on that album. Never got out. Love Is Like a Rock never got out. They ended up putting out My Girl as a single, which charted pretty well, but it really didn't reflect what the band was, the rock kind of angle of the band.
Right.
So making that third album, the mood of myself and Donnie, you know, we felt we had done some good work on King Cool, and it really never got reflected for one reason or another in what MCA Universal did with it and what the success was on their record. So I was a little psychologically, you know, I had to get myself up for making the third record. So that became a challenge. Then the third reason was this local band had thought that one of the demos I had for the third album sounded like a song they had, which was not true. And number one. Number two, Donnie's the one who had access to this song that they had played. And up until that time, Donnie had no input into the demo I had produced for this. So there was no rational reason there was no access, you know, but nevertheless, they were pressing their claims and we were already going through this lawsuit for Aaliyah. So, I didn't want to go through something like that again. Now, I'm an attorney now. If I knew what I knew now, back then, I would have just brushed it off. But at the time, it bothered me. So I had to rewrite all that whole first song, which is what I did. So that got to be a pain in the ass. Yeah. So everything together, the third album was not a labor of love. It was challenge.
As much as I love the debut, filled to the brim with greatness, King Cool, I thought, was an even better album because, like I said, it was felt more emotional, more something about it. My Girl, I mean, when you hear those harmonies of My Girl, it sounds, you know, 50s doo-wop influence, whatever. But if you tear off the top layer, you hear Beatles harmonies in there.
We
you know,
hugely influenced by the Beatles. I mean, it's all over the place. And actually, Donnie and I would, I mean, Donnie, his voice, he, you know, we would say, be John in this one, be Paul in this one. He could, he knows what I mean. And he can, and he would cop that attitude. I'm a huge Beatles fan, no question about it. In fact, we did a Christmas CD called Alleluia. I did it in the style of like Sgt. Pepper, if you really kind of listen to it. I mean, there's an intro. And then it goes, you know, Blue Christmas is our sort of, with a little help from my friends. And you can hear the Sgt. Pepper kind of influence through the whole record. I'm a huge Beatles fan. There's no question about it.
Now, this is a much tougher record, too. It's a much harder record than you've done. But I think, like tough, when you think of a song like Always the Last to Know off of King Cool, which Donnie has this just this glorious emotional falsetto. Agreed. But then it's there on Tough World 2, which is the polar opposite. It's this tough rocker. And he manages to pull out this stuff. But this album is still full of great pop music.
You know, I listened to it, of course, for the first time in many years because of the Rock Candy releases, and applauding Derek and his team for wanting to release it and for really putting a lot of work and art into it. Because I'm really proud of the releases. I'm really thrilled he's done what he's done with this thing. But I, listening to it after all these years, I liked Tough World. I liked This Time It Must Be Love. Yep. I think those are good songs. I liked I Want to Tell Her. You know, it was like I listened to that song like a layperson, not having written it or having spent hours in the studio on it because I had forgotten it. And I was telling Marty, I'm listening to it as if I'm just a listener listening to it for the first time, and I'm kind of enjoying it. And then it's getting to the bridge. It hadn't gotten there yet. And I'm thinking to myself, well, this is like surreal. I have no idea where it's going to go in the bridge. All I know is it's going to be freaking weird. And because I know it's going to be weird. And it was weird, but I enjoyed it. So I like that song. There are songs on that album that reflect the tired uphill slog it was to make that record. Like You're Gonna Miss Me is one that I didn't enjoy it all. The High and the Mighty, I thought was just, you know, I'm just speaking frankly now. I hate that song.
So do I.
Really hate it. That was the song that, you know, just I redid, and I wish we had just left it off the record. You know, we only had 9 songs on that record. All in all, it's not the quality of like the King Cool record, but it had a couple of good songs.
Yeah. Parallel Time, Love is Magic.
You know, I have no idea what was the single from the third album. I have, I hope it would have been Tough World.
Tough World was the first single.
Yeah, and I guess it didn't do anything because I don't even remember it being out, and I don't think it charted, but I don't mind Tough World. I think that was a decent song. We do that live, and it, you know, we enjoy it. Can't you see it too? I want to know. You have to read it in between the lines. Do you confuse? What does it take to make you understand? Do you confuse? I'm trying to tell you I'm in love with you.
Now we're going to talk about your fourth album for MCA real fast here. And it's probably my favorite of the bunch. And that's Fortune 410.
That's interesting that it's your favorite. And I'm pleased to hear that.
It's kind of all the best bits of the three previous albums, you know, the great harmonies, the great melodies, the great playing, the inventive, the quirkiness, and, you know, the softness and the toughness, all of that sort of came together on this album. Now, am I saying it's a better album than King Cool? No. Am I saying it's a better album than the first album? No. But I'm saying it's my favorite.
Well,
but,
you know, I appreciate those comments. I'll tell you, here's what happened there. I think Kevin and Marty were tired of Jerry's. I thought we needed a change anyway, because we, you know, let's just switch studios and whatever challenges and opportunities that bring, let's do that. And around that time, I went through some personal changes. I decided to get healthy. I quit smoking, started jogging, got into computers in a big way within the span of like 4 months. Somebody bought me a little Timex computer, I remember. And then I graduated some Atari thing and I began to learn how to program. And anybody who knows me knows I have two sayings that I used to always say: anything worth doing is worth overdoing. And let's create the illusion of progress. I learned that from another engineer. Whenever we'd be in the studio and we get hung up, I'd just say, well, let's just do something. Let's add a tambourine part to this, you know, create the illusion of progress. And then anything worth doing is worth overdoing, which people like to say about me. Whenever I do anything, I get into it all the way. So, you know, stacking is an example. And there's many other examples, both good and bad, in my life that I will do that with. So I got into fitness in a big way. I got into computers in a big way. So we went into this studio now that was more state-of-the-art, more squeaky clean. You know, I wasn't smoking anymore. I got into computers, writing songs about computers. And so I decided not to stack as much anymore. And to, you know, I got a new keyboard, the Rhodes Chroma, which doesn't exist anymore. And that Chroma is all over the record. And I enjoyed that record, Steve, when I listened to it for the first time in many years because of these remasters. I didn't enjoy all of it. I thought there were a couple songs that weren't, you know, great, but that's just me. But I enjoyed in listening to these songs as if for the first time. And Donnie and I were talking about, and Marty were talking about that record and enjoying a lot of that material. I mean, I noticed that the Chroma keyboard is like so much a part of how I wrote a lot of those songs and how I arranged them, how they came to be. But we still stacked a little bit, like in Do You Compute. We enjoyed songs like I'm a User. Donnie really loves Tell Me What You Want. He thought that was really a cool song. So we enjoyed a lot of that stuff.
I mean, Human Evolution, great inventive vocals. Somebody is you know, great ballad. I love, absolutely love Marty's guitar at the end of Cry If You Want To. There's a lot of emotion in that playing, which yeah, you know, and this still is an incredible record. Like I said, it's my personal favorite. After this, of course, this is when the relationship with MCA ended. Was it a four album deal? Was that like a, were you fine leaving the label, or was it a regime change?
I was fine leaving the label. I mean, I don't know if it was a four album deal. I think what probably happened was, you know, what the way I understand record deals to be, since I am now an attorney and I understand how these things work. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I think it was probably a seven album deal they had with the production company. MCA did with the production company. It's always at the label's discretion to pick up an option. After the fourth album, when it didn't yield in those days, a platinum record, which would have been successful. I think they decided to drop the band. And I think we were all fine with that at that point. And we went on from there to make a couple of other records that, you know, and then we all, yeah, you know, it's okay. It's okay. And then we, went on to have our own private journeys at that point, every member of the band. Mm-hmm. And then we got together for a couple of albums that, yeah. And then we did Pole Town, which I think I will say is an interesting record. I kind of like Pole Town. I think we like Pole Town. We went back to Jerry's for that record. There was no stacking on that record. Al Britton was a part of that record. So you had the original band. I think there were some very interesting things on that record. It's not classically a Donnie Iris sounding.
Are you going to mend it?
How are you going to mend it? I liked.
It's one of my favorite. One of my favorite Donnie Iris songs.
You know, you're right. I like that song. And in fact, there was a girl out, I forgot her name, who did a cover version of that. That's just beautiful. But I like How You're Gonna Mend It. I would like to reproduce that maybe with the band in a different way. But I think that's a good song. And then we did the Christmas CD, which I really like a lot. I encourage your viewers to find our Christmas CD. I think it's a good piece of work. I'll tell you what I think is a bad piece of work. I'll tell you what I think is a good piece of work. And that was a good piece of work, I think.
Before we close this out, you know, Rock Candy has done a phenomenal job.
Yeah, totally agree.
In the remasters.
The Rock Candy remixes, the Donnie Iris stuff has never sounded better than what they put out.
It's absolutely incredible sounding. And of course, for completists, there was a promo-only EP, live EP, that had come out in 81, I believe. And it featured like five tracks, and those five tracks are spread over these four CDs as bonus tracks.
Yeah. We played the Paradise Theater in Boston, which is a legendary club. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I remember playing that gig, and they, it was recorded, and I had some trepidation about it being recorded. We had the opportunity to mix the live recording. So we actually did that.
Now, before we lose you, Mark, I got one thing for you. I have this.
Wow!
Stand up.
I didn't even know you had that.
Are there any other promo items that MCA did back then? I think I got a couple of buttons somewhere.
Probably, I have no idea what they are. I mean, I wouldn't have them anymore. But yeah, they probably did. They probably did stuff like that. You know, we have some shows coming up, COVID willing. I hope.
Yeah.
You know, they go through. We just played with Styx last.
Yes.
Thursday. At Youngstown Foundation Amphitheater, 4,000 people. Styx was phenomenal, by the way, still a great sounding band. And we had the pleasure of opening for them. Since it was in Youngstown, that's equidistant from Pittsburgh and Cleveland, there were a lot of our fans there.
So awesome.
We had a great reception. It was great playing after a couple of years off because of COVID. We have some dates coming up. If they go through, I wish you guys could make them. We have a date October 9th in Pittsburgh 2021, for those of you watching this years from now. And, you know, that'll be a good date. We have a date in November, December. It'd be a pleasure to meet you.
Steve, let's go to Pittsburgh.
How can viewers keep updated on all things Donnie Iris and the Cruisers and Mark Avsec? Is there a website that they can go to, or a Facebook page?
Terrific at our the social media. I sort of don't participate in it. We have a DonnieIris.com website. Mm-hmm. It's not terrific. We may redo it and get committed to having active social media on it. You know, it's not up to date all the time. There is a really good website that was started by some fans led by Glenn and some others. Parallel Time. Are you familiar with that website?
Yep.
I believe it's www.parallel-time.com. I'm not sure. They are better at keeping up with us than we are. In fact, sometimes I go to their website to find out what's going on. But that was started by some fans in the late 90s.
Yeah.
And it was actually, it influenced me and motivated me to continue at a time in our lives when we may have dropped the whole thing. But I just thought, well, these fans just care so much about our music that, you know, motivated me to, you know, continue to make records like Pole Town. And so, you know, I think they're very much into the reissues and like them very much.
And there's also a Facebook page for Parallel Time.
I'll tell you, the band, you know, just so you know, the band loves each other. We all love each other still. So I think we're success story. I like to say we always made just enough money to stay together and to keep doing it, but never too much money that we fought among ourselves.
Yeah.
And I like the way it all turned out. We love each other. We all get along great in the band. I honestly think the band has never sounded better, and we just enjoy being on stage together, making music. It's great.
That's it for this episode of Beach Blanket Fort Bingo. Ronnie Barnett and myself would like to thank the, in my opinion, the legendary Mark Avsec from Donnie Iris and the Cruisers for speaking with us. It has been a pure honor to speak to you, Mark. And we look forward to flying to Pittsburgh when we have the money and going to see Donnie Iris and the Cruisers. They are still active. They are playing live and they are still just as talented and wonderful as ever. And we thank you all for watching and for hanging out here at the Blanket Fort. And we'll see you next time. Goodbye, everybody. Okay. I'm going to admit, I'm not a big fan of Stage Door Johnny, but
yeah, I hate that. That's a
okay. Air fist bump. Air fist bump. There you go.
Yeah. Hate it. You guys both hate the same songs. I love that.